So, in summary about generative models, there are some good things about it, right? It's pure probability, right? Very, very clean probabilistic thing. In fact, it's been known for a very long time, which should give you a hint that it's not going to be the most powerful method used because it comes from a time when computers were non-existent or scarce, and we had to use a lot of mathematical reasoning, pure mathematics, in order to do the work. But it is on, it says here, firm probabilistic grounding. It allows you to use your priors. So if you have priors, maybe your context gives you a prior. I know that I'm in a bedroom, so the probability of seeing a lamp is a lot higher than if I'm in a garage. Okay? That kind of thing. So I can have a prior built into it. One that's in yellow here, actually, there's two of them that are in yellow because I think they actually are important. One is that because you're doing this parametric modeling of continuous functions, you can actually get away with using a pretty small amount of data compared to other methods we're going to look at later, the discriminative methods. So that's one. And the second good thing about it is your models are about each category and just about the category. So when you tell me about some new category, I just have to learn a model for that category. I don't have to play with this model. Whereas if I'm trying to learn how to distinguish between an A and a B and an A and a C, now you tell me about D's, I have to worry about A's versus D's as well. So when you add in new categories and you're trying to discriminate, you often have to worry about a lot of different categories. In the generative model, I just build a model for that new category. There are some other advantages of generative models that we haven't talked about. You can use unlabeled data in interesting ways. You can also use it to generate data, right? So if I say something is distributive or Gaussian, I can actually make more examples, and there are times when that's useful. So that would be all the good news. What always follows the good news is the not so good news. So where did you get those priors? Okay, so again, you go to Greece, you go to the Sears prior store. The sensitivity of the priors really matters, and the priors can be affected by things like context. There's this other thing that's also kind of annoying. I'm modeling skin, and I've got not skin. Well, skin, you might say, is a plausible model. Not skin? Modeling not skin is kind of a weird thing, right? What I really want to do is model sort of the boundary between all the stuff that's skin and everything else that's out there. And by the way, a lot of the stuff that's out there doesn't look anything like skin at all, so that stuff is easy. What I really need to worry about are the things that are kind of like skin but aren't. And in fact, that's the next example. It says, the example hard cases aren't special, and they should be, right? So if I'm trying to recognize, rattlesnakes in the brush, I don't have to worry about what Maseratis look like. I do have to worry about the difference between what rattlesnakes look like and maybe different kinds of grass, because there's a tight similarity between them. So this idea that modeling the hard cases is really what's important. In fact, I think that's what's most important about discriminative learning. And then the last thing is, if you have lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of data, it doesn't really help. If I'm modeling my world as a sort of a single distribution, once I have enough data, I can fit some nice mixture of Gaussians, I'm done. It's not helping me in comparing against other elements. So it's not really leveraging having large data. So those are the downsides of generative models.